And away we go. Just chilling here. Beautiful evening in California. Spring at its finest. And it's important to know that there is a place within us that is untouched by nature, by the universe, by everything that's happening, by the dance of energy and Maya and all that. There's a place within us that is undisturbed by it, entirely undisturbed by it. And we don't know when we will realize this fact and accept it. It's already there. It's already there. It doesn't mean that the universe disappears. It doesn't mean that we can't function. It doesn't mean anything like that. We still see the personality. The personality is still there. The functioning is still there. Everything is still there. But we're also aware concurrently that there's something, a place, as it were, a state of mind that is undisturbed. It's an undisturbed state of mind. That's our goal, that undisturbed state of mind, which is actually God's eternal, flawless, seamless non-judgment upon all hypotheticals, keeping in mind that all of this external, the universe, all of this impermanence is a hypothetical. It's basically Spirit saying, what if this were possible? What if it were possible that reality could be changed, that it's not eternal, that the way that reality is, it's not endless and eternal. What if it was impermanent? So we're dreaming a dream, a what-ifing of impermanence. And God's response to this is concurrent with the beginning of this, which is to say no judgment upon any of it, regardless of whatever form this impermanence takes, whatever the play is, it doesn't matter. So this undisturbed area in our mind, this place in our mind, which is really God's eternal non-judgment upon all hypotheticals, is undisturbed by all hypotheticals. It's not being disturbed. This non-judgment is not being disturbed in any way. This is samadhi. This is nirvana. This is abiding in the self. This is the vision of Christ. That's what it is. It's already present within us. The only problem we have is a continuity issue. We're kind of worried about continuity. So we're talking about that and trying to overcome this kind of dread of like, oh my gosh, what's going to happen, etc. Again, nothing happens in the external world. Everything remains the same. It's just now we're aware that there's this concurrent undisturbedness within us. That's all. We can still do our taping, still do our listening, still do our YouTube, still do everything that we're used to doing. Still driving our car. Nothing is a problem. It's just we're concurrently aware that there's and our mind, there's a mental state that is undisturbed by all of this. No matter what happens, it remains steady, smooth, seamless, undisturbed. No matter what stones you throw in this lake, all these pebbles and rocks and stones are falling into the lake, and the lake remains perfectly calm. It's like, wow. So it's not a problem. This is what we need to be reminded and reassured of. So welcome to Christ Clarity, reassurance. Reassurance and clarity about this undisturbed state, which some call Christ consciousness, Krishna consciousness, Buddha nature. All the same, speaking of the same thing, vision of oneness, the overlay, unconditional love. It's really the prime creator's non-judgment upon all hypotheticals, concurrent with the same instant as we began to entertain hypotheticals. Why do we entertain hypotheticals? Because we want to change reality. We want to be prime creator. We want to say, I wonder if we could change reality and we could be prime creator. It's just, it's like it was a whim. It's a whim. I wonder if we could do that as a whim. And then the mind presents this plausible hypothetical scenario about plausibly being able to accomplish it, or it's plausibly possible, even though it's impossible. So we dwell in this hypothetical land of plausibility, with this hypothetical home of nature, etc., etc., etc. But we are not hypotheticals. We are real. Reality is real. We are created real. Everything that is created is real, and it's eternal. It's not impermanent. And so we're just hanging out here, taking a look at this. And it's a very important thing to do, because the future is very hectic. I'm having a lot of problems now, because the way I was set up and geared was to be aware of the future and then warn people about what's coming. That's how I've always been. But what's coming now is so unnerving, I can't maintain my awareness of it. it's too terrible. So I've got to find this place within that is undisturbed by anything, and pay more attention to that, rather, because it doesn't matter to that. It doesn't matter what's coming. Doesn't matter at all. The whole universe could blow up into pieces. It wouldn't disturb this place within us at all. We need to find this, accept this place within us. This deep calm, because the future is not calm, okay? But no matter what the future is, whether it's nice or bad, whatever, existence is chaotic, it's hectic, it's conflicted, it's destructive, it is problematical, it is death-based, it is fear-based, it is terrible, no matter what. No matter what, whether, you know, the idea, let me put it this way, time is dystopian, period. It's not these times or those times or whatever, it's all, time itself is dystopian. It's fear-based, it's hypothetical-based, it's what if the universe wasn't permanent, wasn't set. What if the permanent was impermanent? What if reality was impermanent? In other words, what if reality just fell apart and died and disappeared? It was annihilated. That's dystopian. It's not a utopia. So the attempt to build a utopia in dystopia, in time, is the worst thing you can do. It is the worst thing you can try to do. And that's what's happening in this world now. That's why we're in such a yucky situation, is there is this all-out attempt to build a utopia in the dystopian context of time. That's the height of folly, or the depth of folly, really. And that's not a good thing to do. Let me adjust this here. We'll take a little break with the intensity of this. All right. It's not a good thing to do. It's a crazy thing, and it ends up being a disaster. Disaster. Because you bend yourself in all sorts of knots trying to find a way to adjust and accommodate to the dystopian nature of time. So, wisdom says, accept this time, dystopian nature of time as it is, and realize and experience that it doesn't disturb this God's non-judgment upon all hypotheticals. It doesn't disturb it. There's a place within us which is peaceful, calm, undisturbed, and blissful, and abide in that. Abide in that while we're here in this world. That's all. Don't try to change time. Don't try to make a utopia here. Don't try to pretend that time is not dystopian. It is. It's entirely dystopian. All right, let me see here. The sun is sinking. The sunset is going down, so that's why the light is changing. So the more we keep tuning into events in the world, the more nervous we're going to have. We're going to have a nervous breakdown. That's what's been happening to me really bad, because I've been lately paying attention to the news I shouldn't be. There's a kind of like a fascination with it, like a train wreck. You're kind of looking at how's the train wreck coming, you know, and it's like, wow, it's worse than we, you know, could imagine. It really is. And it's just, I got to train myself not to look at it, as everyone should. And instead, look within for that place, that's the undisturbed place of perfect peace and repose and calm, which is God's eternal and seamless, concurrent blessing of non-judgment upon all hypotheticals. Everything. Doesn't matter what the hypothetical is. It's simply, what if, dot, 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 that's it. God doesn't go any further than that. What if? Non-judgment upon it. What if I were happy? Still non-judgment. What if I were sad? Non-judgment. You see, everything in hypothetical land is duality, because it's like, what if I was happy? That's based on what if I was sad too. There's two sides to every coin of hypotheticalness. That's duality. So don't seek happiness within duality. Whereas God's non-judgment upon all of it is not dualistic. You see, He's not saying, God's not saying, He's only saying no judgment upon any of it, period. Because what ifs always are dualistic. What if I was eternal? Well, that still can be countered by what if I wasn't eternal? See, reality is not based on what ifs. Reality just is. It just simply is what it is. It's not what if I were eternal, or what if reality was real. You still have the what if it wasn't real. So hypotheticals are inherently dualistic. They're always subject to the other side of the what if. What if I was happy? Well, what if I was sad? What if I was enlightened? Well, what if I wasn't enlightenment? You see, it's like that. There's nothing you can do to prevent this dualistic dance of what we call hypothetical land. Existence. It's a dualistic dance. It's all what if. What if I got free? Well, what if I didn't get free? Dualism. Instead, accept God's non-judgment upon all hypotheticals. Upon what if I got free and what if I didn't get free. Non-judgment upon both of them. You see how that works? You get a sense like, hey, that works. That's not duality. That's freedom from duality. Non-judgment from the Prime Creator is freedom from duality. It is enlightenment, is salvation. And we already have it. We're just nervous about the continuity issue. So we kind of want to say, we're thinking, how can we fit in with the events of the world and all these changes and stuff that's happening and still be enlightened? Well, the fact is that whether anyone fits in or not, they're still undisturbed, okay? And why not fit in? You know, fit in there any way you want to. It doesn't disturb you. It doesn't disturb you at all. So as far as making all the adjustments that come, well, there may be something to that as far as the massive changes and adjustments that are coming, which are intended to just freak people out and stress them out. Again, which I say is relocation is a real alternative, which I have continually been shown as an alternative. If it happens, it happens. But we still have to focus in on this internal place of non-judgment within us. Okay, that is all important. The more clarity we have about this, the easier it will be to deal with any situation, whether it's remaining in this dystopian nightmare, or relocating to some other situation, maybe a death-free realm, higher dimensional type of situation. A lot of possibilities. But this dystopian nightmare, it's always, time is always a dystopian nightmare. It is a nightmare. It's duality. It's unstable. You say, yeah, what if we lived in this wonderful place? Yeah, but what if we lived in a terrible place? There's no stability. That's why Jesus said, don't build your house on straw, the straw of hypotheticals. Build it on a rock, which is the rock of God's non-judgment upon all hypotheticals, eternal non-judgment, not just non-judgment right now, but for all hypotheticals that could ever arise. And the non-judgment continues on. There's no point where it says, okay, I've not judged hypotheticals for trillions of years, now I'm going to start judging. No. It's eternal non-judgment. Never will the Prime Creator ever judge hypotheticals, any of them. So this provides additional clarity to all the spiritual teaching of the past about abiding in the self, like Ramana says. It sets a clearer context, which is why that was my purpose of coming here. Set the clearer context. It's God's eternal, seamless, concurrent blessing of non-judgment upon all hypotheticals. That is the bliss. That is the great calm that Ramana Maharshi talked about. The great calm. The great calm. Beyond any pleasurable states or even euphoric states or rapturous states or any of this, type of stuff. It's the deep calm. And it's already there. It's always been there, concurrent with the first instant of engaging with what if this non-judgment was there concurrently. Not before, not after. So this is what the clarification is all about. And then there's additional teaching about possible relocation. It is possible. I don't have, hard facts about it. I do not have hard facts about it. I'm just saying that is a possibility. It's also possible to remain in this world completely undisturbed by whatever happens. Absolutely. Absolutely. However, what I'm seeing is a lot of people are struggling to try to get to this place of non-judgment, God's non-judgment, not our non-judgment. It's God's non-judgment. See, a lot of people are struggling to get there, and the times are getting very, very difficult. It's the turnover times. It's the end times. It is essentially an attempt to establish a utopia on this planet. You can call it communism, socialism, whatever you want to call it, or unrestrained capitalism, which we know is not a utopia for sure. But it's not an attempt to make it a utopia, you see. Whereas communism, socialism is the belief that we can establish a utopia in this dystopian context of time. So what happens is there's a lot of head bashing, and there's a lot of restrictions and laws and tightening the screws on everybody, groupthink, hive mind, all this kind of stuff. And it's been tried and tried and tried, and inevitably people just say, yuck, you know, this is absolutely terrible. And then they swing back towards more free market capitalism, which itself is, again, is a nightmare. Of course, it's a nightmare. Absolutely it is. Especially the modern version. Simple rural agricultural life is less of a nightmare than what we have here. It's probably the best, you know, that we can do is not making any attempt to try and to make a utopia. No, just, you know, let's just get by. So we're in those times now where there is just this juggernaut. Maybe you've seen the juggernaut in Puri. They're dragging it in India. They're dragging this huge, huge carriage through the streets, the juggernaut. massive whatever you want to call it, I don't know what you call it, image, and this juggernaut, once it gets going, you know, it just doesn't stop. It just crushes everything in its way because the momentum is so great. You get the juggernaut going and it just ends up, you know, crushing everything. So what has happened is the world, we built a juggernaut, and this juggernaut is now moving, and it's out of our control. It's out of our control. We built a Frankenstein monster, is another way of putting it. And we realize, wait a minute, you know, well, put the brakes on. No brakes. It's like a massive avalanche of boulders. We've dislodged these boulders, and they're going down the mountainside, and they're picking up more boulders as they go along, and it's an avalanche. And we say, whoa, stop. It's not stopping. You don't stop an avalanche because there's no mechanism to stop it. You get out of the way of the avalanche is what you do. So we need to realize that we have unleashed this avalanche, a landslide, a juggernaut, upon ourselves. And we've designed it to not have any brakes. That's a fact. Because we feel that if we just force ourselves, we can make a utopia. If we just stop all the brakes, because we think, well, maybe we've not succeeded in the past because we put the brakes on it. So now we've decided no brakes. Let's see what happens if we have no brakes. Right? Maybe we think we've been too cautious. So let's throw caution out of the wind. No brakes. And see what happens. Well, what happens is not what we want. And too late, we realize we've created a juggernaut. We say, uh-oh, we're in big trouble. Absolutely, we're in big trouble. Now, don't you think that there are those who are perfectly aware of all this and know that, hey, you know, you're into creating a juggernaut, and all this was known way in advance, of course. Of course, we're as shifty as we seem to be. Existence is not some mystery as far as what happens. It's very predictable, like a child is actually quite predictable in many ways. So, it was foreseen that we would create this juggernaut, this Frankenstein, this landslide, this avalanche, to come upon us without any restraint and just crush our resistance. And so. Steps have been taken ahead of time to sidestep that. Again, it can't be stopped, but it can be sidestepped. This is a very important teaching. What we have done is we've unleashed something upon ourselves that can't be stopped, but it can be sidestepped. an avalanche is coming down. You can't stop it. It's got too much momentum. You have to get out of the way. Get out of the way. So what's happening is people are spending their time trying to stop it. And, you know, that's, I would advise that that's folly. But from what I see, that is folly. That is what you don't want to get engaged in, because that is a big, big problem. Big, big problem. It's, why would anyone do that? You see, that is the question. It's a lot to do with ignorance. Something to do with pride. Something to do with ignorance. And it doesn't work. Because, again, let us just be honest. Be honest with ourselves and say, we have intentionally designed this juggernaut to crush us. So that in the crushing of the grapes, we think we're going to get the wine. Okay? We're trying to extract something from ourselves by pressuring ourselves in an ungodly, terrible way. Hoping that by doing this, we're somehow going to get some extract from this. That is going to be the wine of immortality, right? So we're doing it to ourselves. But we must remember that our will, the will to do this to ourselves, has been building for a long time, and we've decided that this is what we're going to do. This is why we're here. We're going to crush ourselves. This world is a death trap. This world is a death trap. And all this stuff in the world to keep us here, to keep us from sidestepping, are simply decoys. Okay, decoys. What is a decoy? Of course, you know, like if you're a duck hunter, you make these ducks that look like real ducks, and they're very, very well done, and they're placed there, and other ducks say, oh, they come down and say hello to the duck, and then the hunters are there, boom. Okay, decoy is a decoy. So in this world, in order to keep us here, and so we don't sidestep the problems, there's all these decoys. We again have intentionally set this all up to decoy ourselves so that we remain here, so we get crushed. What can I do here? I don't know. The lighting is, you can go like that, and go like that. It's adjusting conditions are really tough to, well, there we go. The decoys in this world are many, 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 and we've all set this all up. I call them the sirens. Now, the sirens were, of course, a great, some ancient mythological beings in, like, what, Greek mythology, the sirens that would sing songs to sailors. The sirens had a taste for human flesh, apparently. And they saw these ships, and they said, "How we want to eat the sailors on board. How can we get them?" And so they sang, they got near these dangerous shoals, these reefs that would wreck a ship if the ship went onto these reefs. And they got near them, and they began singing these beautiful songs. And they probably had beautiful costumes and ornamentation on, and they looked so beguiling, you know, so beguiling. And the songs, the sailors heard these songs, and they said, "Wow, I'm gonna... this is wonderful. Let me get closer. Let me hear this song. Where's that coming from?" They get closer and closer, and they see the sirens. The sirens are so beautiful, singing these beautiful songs. They say, "Oh my gosh, let's get closer. Let's get closer and closer and closer." And before you know it, boom. Ship runs aground, wrecked, sinks. Sailors get cast in the ocean. They drown. The sirens then go fish them out of the ocean and feast on their flesh. Very nasty thing. So the sirens are decoys. The siren songs are decoys to keep us here, to keep us from sidestepping, to keep us so that we get crushed, and out of our crushing supposedly some sort of essence is supposed to emerge, which is just a pipe dream. It's not true. So we don't want to get attracted to the siren's song here. We want to sidestep it. So part of the difficulty of this world is this, the siren song. We've designed it to sing so beautifully in the world, to attract our attention externally to the world instead of internally to the place, undisturbed place within us. the siren song is, it seems to be everywhere in the world now. My gosh, it's incredible how ubiquitous it is. No matter where you go, you seem to feel this you know, the Babylon, and the Bible called it the Whore of Babylon. Babylon was this place of the flesh with all this opulent, magnificent grandiosity. The siren song of this world was being sung in so many different ways. Well, it is now, you know, the whole world is Babylon like that. We're being attracted here to decoys. We're saying, oh, look at that beautiful something, and then boom, you see. So we have to be aware of this and try to tune it out as much as possible. But the siren song of the world is to keep us bound here, so that we will get crushed. That's the honest situation. Okay. And it's becoming so powerful. It's amazing. It's amazing. It's amazing what's going on. There's also false guilt being used. There's all sorts of techniques that are being used now, is to try and claim victimization, try to say you have to stay here to stand trial for something, that, you know, whatever it takes to keep you here. We have designed something to do that. We have. We're not aware of it, but if you're honest, we'll admit that we have done that. And in our fragmented hypotheticalness, we can easily compartmentalize stuff. And the fact is, this is all one dream, and so different aspects of the dream are still coming from the same dreaming, same hypotheticalness. So we have worked to entrap ourselves here in this death trap. So we get crushed. So out of this being crushed, we hypothesize that something is going to emerge from it. An elixir of immortality is going to emerge. Just like crushing grapes for make fine wine out of the grapes, and we believe that this will happen. It's amazing here in the Bay Area. The mania around wine here is just, you can't believe it. You really can't believe it. It is so incredibly important to so many people here. It's just like wine, because all the grapes, incredible amount of grapes have been planted in California. Incredible amount. I mean, there are a lot of homes in this area who, on their property, they have vineyards. They have their own vineyards. Very sophisticated stuff. And they make their own wine. What is this all about, wine making? It's all about crushing the grapes. This is a symbolic foreshadowing, as it were, of what this world's going to happen. The grapes are going to be crushed. How they say the grapes are pressed in the wine press of God's wrath, or something like that. Well, it's not God's wrath. It's our own wrath. It's our own. We're the ones who set up the wine press. We're the ones who want to throw the grapes, the bodies, into the wine press and crush them. But we don't have to. We don't have to at all. It's just, I've explained how it's all folly. All that is completely folly and totally useless and futile. We're trying to find a way to survive the annihilation of reality. We're trying to build a utopia in time. We're thinking there's some way, if we just all get crushed together, it's going to produce this wonderful wine. You might even look at history as like winemaking, and that all this death and disease, all this death, really, which is what time brings, is supposedly producing varietals, different wines. I mean, you go into any store here and the number of wines is just astonishing. Most of them from the Bay Area, most of them from California, you know, around the world. Because everybody's got their own label here. You know, if you have money here, you probably have your own label, own wine label. That's called status. But look at history as simply producing different varieties of wine out of what? Crushing grapes. What are grapes? Bodies. Body, subtle bodies too. And so through all these epochs of time, there's been all these different epochs of time, all these different catastrophes, all these different mass deaths, all constant dying everywhere, and we're all winemakers and making wine out of it, thinking that we got this bottle. And you know, here, if you have money, you have a wine cellar, period. Most homes with money have wine cellars, and they're well stocked with all these different kinds of wine. Wine cellars, yeah, that's very, very common here. So history is like we've all accumulated this wine cellar, and we have all these bottles of wine in there. So yeah, this I remember. This is vintage. You know, this is vintage 1450. This wine here. This is from the bubonic plague. You know, whatever the plague was, I don't know. But these bottles were bottled from all the bubonic plague deaths, and out of all that immense suffering in the hideous way, we extracted this incredible wine. And maybe we drink this, we'll get immortality. And this one was from the smallpox epidemics. And this one is from the famines in Bengal or India or China. You know, the earthquakes, all these different, you know. And this one is just from, you know, the century worth of death. You know, all the death in this century or this decade. What wine is this? Well, this is a varietal from the Europe and Germany, Nazi Germany, concentration camps. Now this was bottled, you know, in 1942 from this concentration. This is representing all the terrible, brutal deaths there, you know. And history is stocking all these bottles of wine. You call it the Akashic Record, call it whatever you want. It all comes from death. It all comes from death. And it doesn't bring immortality, it doesn't bring utopia, it doesn't bring anything. How can hypotheticals bring reality? They can't. They can only bring more hypotheticals. Or as Jesus says, illusions simply breed illusions. That's it. So it's a waste of time. We don't need a wine cellar. We don't need a wine cellar. I guess there's a lot of people that don't want to relocate. They say, well, I mean, what kind of wine cellar are you going to have there? Seriously. I mean, sophistication here is like, What's your dinner going to be like? What's the most important? What's the wine going to be like? And you have to have wine. I mean, you cannot have anybody over dinner unless you have the right wine. So people are saying, well, how can we go to... I'm going to knock out the color on this. It's constantly changing here. The atmosphere and the lighting is changing. So just... how could you have... someplace that doesn't have the wine? It's a question. There's no wine in reality. Okay. So what's happening is the vintners are trying to have a bumper crop of wine, and they've designed it so there's this huge harvest of grapes thrown into the picked and thrown into the wine press, and we're going to be producing an epic, historic, and her-storic wine year. Historic bottling, absolutely. From the unprecedented wine pressing. We got this new method to crush the grapes. It's all temperature controlled. We've figured it all out, and this pressing is going to produce this unbelievable bottling, which is going to knock us all out at some point once it ages properly, etc. We'll all drink it, and we will feel like we're in paradise. That's the notion. So the idea is, we're told each grape is very unique. Each one adds to the overall body and legs of the wine that is to come. The entire body of the wine each one adds their own flavor. And so every, we're told that we're all special. We're all special. We're all going to add to that, that body of the wine. And so you can't leave because you are special. The wine won't be perfect unless you, your grape is crushed also. That's what we're told. Wonder who's telling us that. You know, we're telling ourselves that. But it's insanity speaking to insanity is what it is. And that's what it really is. It's a guilt trip. They say, well, if you sidestep this harvest and the pressing and stuff, then you're not adding your special death to the wine, and it won't be what it needs to be. Which is just a total con. A total con. The wine inherently will never be what it needs to be. Hypotheticals will never be real. Never be real. And we can never be happy with hypotheticals. There is no wine we can drink that'll make us happy with hypotheticals. A hypothetical wine will not make us happy with hypotheticals, because hypotheticals inherently don't make us happy. As again, God, perfect non-judgment upon all hypotheticals, knowing that the Son was not created for hypotheticals, to be happy with hypotheticals. It's impossible. So again, non-cooperation with futility is not a crime, and does not give rise to any guilt. Okay, let free will deal with the situation, because guilt is not in play, even though that we are told it is. We are told, oh no, you're guilty because we're contributing, we're willing to do our part, you're not willing to do yours, so you're causing our suffering. Not true. Ignorance is causing the suffering. Ignorance is causing the suffering. Pride is causing the suffering. Spiritual pride is causing the suffering. It's not sidestepping, it is actually helping minimize the suffering. Because as long as you keep trying to accomplish the impossible, you're suffering. And so by sidestepping, you're saying, hey, it's possible to get free of this folly. It is possible. You're not bound by it. You're not bound by it. Maybe I want to hit this other light because it's... So we're not bound by folly. And the guilt trip is simply insanity, is whimsicality. And we cannot play along with that. If we play along with that, we're actually hurting others. Okay, let me hit this light. All right. So we're actually hurting others. There, that's better. That's even. That's even. There you go. That's better. That's even. Okay, as the sun went down, things got uneven. So this analogy of grapes is a good, very good one, actually. Because it's very apt what's happening. We want to bottle all this wine. Let me say, during this time, we expect an epic vintage from these times. And we've set all up so where everything's crushed in many different ways. And we think by doing it in the way that we're doing it, it is going to provide the best vintage ever. And we're experimenters in hypothetical land. We're experimenting in death. We're seeing what can we get out of death? What can we get out of suffering? What can we get out of misery? What can we get out of crushing ourselves? How do we produce a wine that will intoxicate us and make us happy with hypotheticalness? Can't do it. Cannot do it. God the Father says you can't do it. God the Son says you can't do it. God the Holy Spirit says you can't do it. God the Guru says you can't do it. Reason says you can't do it. Reason says it's whimsical folly, total eccentricity. And yet the eccentric poo-poo this and say, no, if we just keep experimenting, we'll find the answer. Which is, again, that is when I talk about the ego making up laws, or us making up laws, there's an example. If we experiment long enough, we're bound to come up with the answer. That's simply a decree that we've simply made up. We've just made it up. And saying this is a self-evident truth. It is not a self-evident truth. It is not a self-evident truth at all. It's the opposite. It's just a complete insane decree. That's like saying if we keep trying to change reality, we're bound to succeed. Again, that's another law we just made up. It's not God's law. We just decree that this is so. It's self-evidently so. It is not self-evidently so. Evident to what self? Evident to whimsicality. I mean, see, whimsicality believes whatever it wants to be true is true. So, to whimsicality, these decrees are true because it wants them to be true. But God established truth. We didn't establish truth. Truth is true because God wills it to be so. We didn't establish truth, so it's not up to us to decree what is true or not. It's up to us to accept what is true, not to make these decrees and say that it's evident to us because we want it to be so, thus it must be so. That's spiritual pride. Spiritual pride is our biggest problem. That and continuity. Continuity is the real problem because we want to drop our spiritual pride and we're afraid of continuity. Because even if we see that what our problem is, the continuity issue still arises, like we say, uh-oh, maybe we've really distanced ourselves from reality so far. How can we get back? It seems too abrupt, too radical of a shift to make. So that's why we have this perfect non-judgment upon all hypotheticals, which is this bliss, this undisturbedness, which is present, even though everything else is still around us. We still have a sense of continuity, but we realize there's something within us that's just undisturbed. This is undisturbed. And then that solves the continuity problem. So I expect people are having trouble right now. I'm having severe trouble. Depression, really suffering from nervous breakdown, depression. Can't seem to shake it. Can't seem to shake it. And probably won't be able to shake it at the level of external level of hypotheticals. The level of time, it is, you know, I feel like I'm having a total meltdown or complete burnout. Complete collapse, complete burnout. That's because that's what the future is. I'm aware of the future, and I'm feeling the future ahead of time. That's what I've always done, is felt the future ahead of time, before it actually shows up in this particular time frame. So what I'm feeling right now is this just horrible, horrible thing. I can't shake it. It started with Pope Benedict stepping down. That's when it started. It just hit like boom, like that. That was like February 28th. It started right then, February 28th, suddenly I got the jitters and I've not been able to shake it. Because I know that the next pope is the last pope, and that's when the tribulations will hit. And he's here. He's already here. And he is a wild card, to say the least. And the question is this pope leading the world into martyrdom, leading the church into martyrdom? And the way I look at it is, it could very well be. He's a wild card, absolute wild card. You cannot predict what he's going to do. He's already shown that he's willing to completely throw out tradition and protocol and expectations entirely and pay no attention to it. Which means he could do stuff that wisdom says, no, this is not right to do. He could absolutely do that. All the while saying he's only here for the poor and the poor and the poverty and all this stuff. I mean, anyone can say that. Anyone can have a show of humility like that. That doesn't mean anything. Doesn't mean anything. It really doesn't. That's oftentimes a cover, a decoy for something else. Okay? I mean, if you're going to be talking that talk, you need to walk the walk with clarification on everything too. Alright, and if that's not there, then you say, uh-oh, what is this humility a front for? What is it fronting for? I mean, you got to put the truth first. Truth first. Then the show of humility, if you want to, that's fine, no problem. But truth has to be first, okay? Not the other way around. So I'm not trying to put on a show of humility, and I'm out washing the feet of, you know, and doing all this stuff. Now, put truth first. That's true humility. Because that's showing you you're working to overcome your spiritual pride and the belief that you can change reality, and admitting your mistakes. That is true humility. That is true confession. Confessing the mistakes that you've made, the confessing what you've been trying to do, and saying, I realize and I accept this is what I've been trying to do, and I realize and accept it won't work, and I realize and accept God, the Prime Creator, has already solved the entire situation concurrently with its arising, not after. That no moment did I ever have something on God, you know, some trick on God. Never, 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 never. That's true humility. Try that. Try that on. Showcase that, you see. So this show of external humility, of riding buses and paying for preparing his own luggage and all that stuff, you know, doesn't mean anything. Not of itself does it mean anything. Look for other clues of what's going on. Again, is this Pope leading the church into martyrdom? Is the question. And I have a sense that he is. I get that feeling. That's why I'm so nervous. Because you have the church being led, 1.2 billion Catholics being led into martyrdom, and there's no stopping this planet, because the rest, you know, a lot of the other people in the world are hell-bent on martyrdom already. And the church is supposed to prevent that. Supposed to prevent it, you see. And Benedict, for me, he was a very good pope. Very good. And so when he's, meaning he had on a great understanding of certain concepts. He was a very hardliner. He refused to buckle. And him stepping down that way, he was like, oh my gosh, that's bad news. Very bad news. When at least German, I mean, a German steps down like that, that is bad news. They're not prone to doing that sort of thing. And why did he step down? And, you know, has the tale been told? No. He stepped down for some reason that is very problematical. He basically said he cannot handle the future. It's too problematical. And there's stuff going on which he just said, you know what? I'm going to sidestep this, essentially, is what he said. You know, there's something going on there. It's not his health. Every pope in the last 1400 years has died in office sick. Okay. Dead. They died. Feeble. Sick. Come on. It's not his feebleness. It's not his health. It's not anything like that. Something else very, very, very worrisome. He knows more than he's telling, for sure. So when he decided to step down, I said, uh-oh, here it comes. And what else could it be, you know, than leading the church into martyrdom? I mean, the third secret of Fatima, why they didn't want to release it, was because it talks about the martyrdom of the church. It shows that the Pope, the bishops, I mean, the cardinals, the bishops, the priests, the lay, everyone is being massacred. It's just a bloodbath, and Rome gets destroyed, and all this stuff. Prophecy of Malachi, the same thing. Is this Pope will lead the church into these terrible tribulations, ending up with the destruction of Rome, meaning destruction of the church. So this is the time, and when the church starts heading that direction, that's it. There's no more breaks in this world, because there's so many pagans here who can't wait to get into battle and meet their enemy, as it were, meet that which is supposedly, which they need to crush to get the wine out of those grapes. The wrath of the Lord, as they say, is here in this world now, ready to crush the grapes, and the church is supposed to say, no, that is not salvation. That is not salvation. That is delusion. Okay? That's what it's supposed to do. And the church is not supposed to lead the world and it's the body of Christ into martyrdom. Absolutely not. Jesus is supposed to stop that. You know, Jesus showed us it doesn't work. Gave the lie to death. Okay? Death doesn't work. Gave the lie to death. And so the church is supposed to stand up against that. But this Pope has to be watched very, very carefully. My sense is instant nervousness, even before the Pope was elected. But in watching him now, I'm getting even more nervous. And this whole decoy thing in the world of decoys and keeping us here, I've spoken at length about that in previous videos, about how I see it, the siren song. And it seems to me that this Pope has actually emphasized that. The first thing he did is he went to this Marian shrine or church or something, praying to the Mother Mary, whatever they want to call it. And then he washed in the juvenile attention center, washed the feet of the women, which has never been done before in the history of the church, because Christ chose these apostles, 12 men. It's tradition, and there's reason for that. And he just completely ignored all the church law and didn't even pay any attention to that. And so there's things that he's doing which are like very much red flags, because the decoys are principally feminine in this world. Not all, but they're at the root heart of the decoys. Very beautiful sirens, the whole emphasizing that women can solve the problems of the world and turn it into utopia if we just all get together like one big family. And there's many, many ways the feminine is used as a decoy to keep us here so the grapes get crushed. And those ways are being used to the maximum. So this Pope didn't bless the crowd. The first thing he did is he asked for blessing from the crowd. That's not right. He, as a vicar of Christ on this planet, is supposed to bless this planet, the crowd, the body of Christ, with the blessings of Christ. That's how it's supposed to go, from God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, out upon all of those here who are suffering from delusion, and tell them the good news. The gospel means good news. Tell them the good news. Share the good news. And you're not supposed to be asking blessings to the church from the people in St. Peter's Square first. That's a reversal of the direction. It's a reversal. And of course the progressives love it. They say, oh my God, what a great Pope. They love it. They say, finally, breaking with tradition, reversing things, getting it backwards. You don't ask for blessings from those who are deluded and who are death-based belief systems. You bless them with truth so they have something to aim for. My gosh. So the Pope came out, and everything he's doing is like reversing things. And then the first thing you're supposed to do is you're supposed to go to Jesus, who was the showcase of Christ, showcase of God's plan of salvation here on this planet, which is accept God's perfect and eternal non-judgment upon all hypotheticals. Jesus showed us this, and he showed us that death, that what we're trying to do, can never work. Okay, can never work. And that it doesn't touch spirit at all. Okay. He showed us that through the Easter, the crucifixion, the resurrection. And so this Pope, what he's doing, he rejected the crown, on the balcony, he was dressed all dressed in white, he rejected the papal robes and the hat and all this kind of stuff. And people say, oh, that's really great, that's really cool. He, you know, what a humble person or something. And then he asked them blessings with the crown. They say, oh, what humility. The role of the Pope is not one primary humility. It's one of primarily shepherding the flock of the body of Christ, being a good shepherd. Okay, that's what it's supposed to be. And a good shepherd shares the gospel of Christ, which is the good news about God's plan of salvation. That's what the Pope is supposed to be doing. Not putting on a show of humility. That's a side show. So it seems like the sideshow is more important than the real show here. And when you reject the real show, what do you've got? What's the sideshow? Of course, death, winemaking, martyrdom. Because you turn it over to the mob, they're going to go for martyrdom every time here. Absolutely. You cannot turn the asylum over to the inmates. That is abdicating your responsibility, complete abdication of it. You cannot pay homage to the principle of the siren song. You know, first pay homage to Jesus, first pay homage to Christ, representative of God's non-judgment upon all hypotheticals. Jesus, as a representative of that, of a showcase to this particular religion, you're supposed to go to that first. Instead, he went to Mary first. That's not right. That is not right. And he asked for the blessing of the crowd to him instead of him blessing the crowd. He's the that's a reversing of directions. That is not right. Washing the feet of women on the the Last Supper celebration. Did that on Thursday? I was at Thursday. That has never been done before, and it's not supposed to be done. It is literally against church law entirely. Very important. Breaking with church law. And of course he's gaining like tremendous cachet with the progressives, the communists, the socialists, the secular humanists, all the progressives who want to build a utopia in dystopia of time, which is going to result in incredible suffering and death. They're loving it. They're loving it. They say, finally we got a pope. Finally they have a pope, you see. So this is worrisome. Again, the prophecy of Malachi is that this pope is number 112, is the final pope. No more after this pope. And it will bring destruction of the church will take place during this papacy. Prophecy of Fatima, same thing. Third prophecy of Fatima is the same thing. Now, I'm not against Mary, the Immaculate Virgin, at all, but there's been an idol made of that. And I'm definitely warning you that the idol that is distracting you from the helpfulness of that feminine principle, that idol definitely is a siren. Okay, it's definitely a siren. It's the chief of all sirens. It's Isis, Osiris. It's the mystery religions, the mother-based, goddess-based mystery religions of the past were idolatry, siren religions that were distracting us away from God's plan of salvation. The family of Christ is the family of those who are working to clarify God's plan of salvation and accept it for themselves to repent. The family of those who are focused on repentance, that is the body of Christ. And you don't have to go to church to do that. You don't have to belong to any particular religion to be doing that. All right? You don't have to be doing any rituals or engaging with dogma to do that. Repentance is something real that you can do right here, right now, by clarifying what God's plan of salvation is, and what the mistake we have made is, and what the correction is. Okay? Mistake is we think we can kill God. Jesus showed us what we want. We're trying to do. We're trying to kill God. So he gave himself up to that plan, agenda we have to show us this is what you're trying to do. And then he showed us on Easter Sunday, you can't kill God. Okay, you're trying to do the impossible. Now, and then after we see that, then since we can't kill God, we're trying to, we can't. And then how do we deal with the continuity problem? Okay, that's then what the apostles are supposed, and the Holy Spirit guiding the body of Christ, the apostles and the body of Christ, to clarify that to us. So I'm part of that. I'm part of Jesus' team, as it were, which is really the Holy Spirit's team, which is really God's team, which is all those who are working towards repentance, to recognize the mistake, see that we can never kill God, and this is all hypothetical, and then the only problem we have is a continuity problem, and that is solved by accepting God's eternal, seamless, concurrent blessing of non-judgment upon all hypotheticals. That is the answer, and that leads to this deep, deep calm, which is undisturbed by any hypothetical whatsoever. That's the body of Christ, those who are doing that. Doesn't matter what you call yourself, what religion you call yourself, or what savior you follow, or any of that stuff. Doesn't matter. The repentance is what matters. And the Holy Spirit, the grace of God, is the clarifier that works with us, the right use of time and right use of mind, helping us in that way. So I'm real nervous about what's going on in the world. I can't seem to shake it, you know. I think the world is saying, hey, this Pope is going to solve our problems. I don't see that. You know, so far, he's made me very nervous. Because it seems more trying to, you know, utopian as far as trying to establish a utopia here. It seems more like, hey, let's all get along. Let's all. He said the message of Easter is political solutions to these conflicts. What? What? He prayed for that there be workable political solutions and compromise to these conflicts around the planet. I think the mosquitoes are out now. What? I heard that. Are you kidding me? That's never been the church's message. Yeah, there's a mosquito. Wow. Uh-oh. Hello? No. Let there be repentance on the planet. Let those who engage in these conflicts turn to Christ and repent. That's the message of the Holy Spirit. It's not, let's try and work about political solutions and stuff, all this kind of stuff. No, that's not the purpose of the followers of Christ to say that. That's the purpose of the ego, the Antichrist, to keep telling us that we can solve our own problems instead of God solving the problems for us. So I'm telling you that this what's taking place is worrisome, to say the least. Those are not the words of someone who is in tune with the Holy Spirit. Man, we never say such a thing. Political solutions? Are you kidding? And that's the prayer of Easter? Are you kidding? That's Easter's Jesus saying, look, what you're trying to do can never work. Can never work. It only leads to death. It only leads to the cross. The attempt to find political solutions, man-made solutions, ego-based solutions to our problems only leads to the cross. Sorry, mosquito. Blessings upon you, but I'm not going to have you feasting on my blood. I rarely do that. I had to kill a black widow spider a couple days ago, something that certainly appeared to be that. And then a mosquito. The mosquito's going to come and, of course, you know, suck my blood. I'm not interested in being martyred that way either by mosquitoes, you know. Don't want to be martyred by mosquitoes. That already happened one time in my life. 180 mosquito bites on one night, and that was like being crucified. It was horrible. So we will not be martyred. Jesus saved us from martyrdom, came to save us from martyrdom, saying that doesn't work. You can't make a wine out of your martyrdom that is going to satisfy you with hypotheticals. Make hypotheticals real. It would absolutely doesn't work. So I, since Benedict stepped down, I have been a nervous wreck, you know. I said, oh, this is trouble. Because Benedict refused to cave in to the progressive agenda of the planet. He refused. That's why they hated him. They hated him. And, with him stepping down, he said, I just can't take it anymore. Wow. What's going on? He's probably under a psychic assault, you know, or he's under direction of the Holy Spirit pointing out to us, folks, sidestepping is what we need to do. You know, Benedict may have been telling us, hey, look, the problems that are coming are too much for the church, for the body of Christ. Therefore, sidestep it. You know, his resignation, he said, you know what? I can't handle this anymore. I'm going to go to a retreat, which is where he is now. So maybe that is the teaching of the church, of the Holy Spirit. Sidestep it. Brilliant. Brilliant. Germans can be really bad or they can be really good, actually. If they get on it off track, they can be really bad because they're so courageous and determined, and they won't break. But if they are on the right track, then they can really be fabulous. Because they refuse to cave into pressure. Definitely refuse to cave into pressure. So did Benedict really cave into pressure? Or did he, what he was saying was, folks, body of Christ, world, the pressure that is coming, I know about it, and I'm telling you, it's designed for your martyrdom, and you don't have to be martyred. I refuse to be martyred, even though, you know, talk about humility. He stepped down from the papacy, from the highest office on, you know, for many, you would say the highest office on the planet, highest position on the planet. He said, no, I'm going to step down. Hey, you know, that's humility, isn't it? And maybe he said, you know what, body of Christ, I want to show you something. What is to come now is going to be so terrible. I want you to relocate. Be willing to set aside your privilege and wealth and everything in this world you have in this world and say, no, it's not worth it. It's not worth it. To him, it wasn't worth remaining Pope, you see. And it's instructive that the utopian progressives hated Benedict. He was like a thorn in their side. It's their wildest dreams that he stepped aside, but you know what? It may actually be the most helpful thing possible, that really a fabulous thing that he did. Showcasing what we need to do as followers of Christ, followers of truth, those who are attempting to repent and accept God's plan of salvation, accept our own, which is to create a utopia and a dystopia of time, which doesn't work. He said, step down from your worldly position. Be willing to step down from your worldly position. Leave all here. Don't worry about taking anything and take refuge. Take refuge. Ha. Interesting. I didn't think about saying this today at all. No thought of this. It's just the Holy Spirit's just bringing this up. And it sounds like it's very accurate, actually. It fits. It really fits. What time is it now? Ah, almost 8 o'clock. Well, maybe that's enough for tonight, because it's some really heavy, heavy stuff, which is what we want. The remedy needs to be, you know, strong, because the problem right now is strong. If I'm having this kind of trouble, it's strong, because I thought I was kind of impervious to this, but apparently not. So, okay. Very, very great. And you know that another video will be coming, which is going to be even more heavier, more intense, and more stuff is just going to be wow. Wow, 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 because it has to be wow. It has to be wow right now. The videos have to just like blow your mind with something that you just haven't even thought about before. So that's what it's all about here. Very great. We'll see you soon.